100 meters below the surface of the earth, just outside of Geneva, Switzerland. This is Area 52. This is Pastor Mike, and I am online, and I am live with you today. Today, it's a happy birthday day. We're going to wish a happy birthday to... I love technology. I love the World Wide Web. That's from Napoleon Dynamite. My daughters made me watch that one night, and I laughed. The World Wide Web. Let's see here. Let me read this, make sure I get it right. I heard something about this on the news this morning, and just want to make sure I heard it right. But anyway, according to the Wikipedia article on the World Wide Web, on August 6, 1991... man by the name of Lee, Berners-Lee, published a short summary of the World Wide Web project on a news group called Alt Hypertext. This date also marked the debut of the web as a publicly available service on the internet, although new users only accessed it after August 23rd, 1991. For this reason, this is considered the Internauts Day. Internaut, N-A-U-T, as sort of a play on nautical, astronaut, things like that. Those who surf the World Wide Web been doing so since August 23, 1991. Does anybody know who invented or whose idea it was for a World Wide Web? Does anybody know? If you say Al Gore, naturally. My sound effects not working. Hang on a second here. I gotta do this. It's all about timing. Here we go. Push this button, push that button, and here we go. If you say Al Gore, you're wrong. It wasn't Al Gore. It was CERN. We're going to talk about CERN today. Have you seen the video? The pictures, have you seen the article about CERN? The Large Hadron Collider with the statue of Shiva doing the Shiva dance because he's on fire, okay? He's flailing around like this. I'm on fire! Ah! Okay, that's Shiva. We're going to talk about that today. If you have not seen this video... the guy that filmed it got freaked out of his mind at a certain point in this video. And let me do that. I'm prepared with pictures. Let me push this button here and let me do this here. Here we go. There is an article and I have it posted to my Facebook page. I have it posted to Facebook.com/Pastor Mike Online. You'll see the address right there where I got my finger. Facebook.com/Pastor Mike Online. You do not need to be a member of Facebook in order to access that page. It is a publicly accessible page. You got to go there and read. I posted several articles that I thought I was going to be dealing with today. And should I happen to run out of time, run out of material on this, which I highly doubt, I'll get into some of these other things. And I had it in my mind yesterday that I was going to do something today related to divination, familiar spirits. I saw an ad in a magazine that was, it was boom, boom, boom. I'm not going to tell you about it. It was incredible. I thought I saw a number in this ad. Subliminal, they used to call it subliminal suggestion. Now it's called perception without awareness. Okay? Which is apparently most of Hillary Clinton's life. Okay? But perception without awareness. Our eyes and our ears and our senses are picking things up around us. And we are actually taking in more information into our brain than what we are consciously aware of. Advertisers know this. And I was looking at this ad and I'm going, I see a number six here. Literally a number six here. Come to find out, according to the people who put the ad out, it was deliberate. They intended to do this. I was going to talk about that today. And, of course, this news about the birthday of the internaut. And this article here, you can find it on, you'll find it everywhere. And I'm sure there's others that have dealt with this issue. But I don't think that most of the YouTube and the bloggers know what the scripture says about it. They just talk about it like it's some conspiracy and it's bad and there's a conspiracy and so on. You can't have conspiracies. They don't work unless you believe the word of God. God is able to see into places, including the thoughts and the intentions of people's hearts. God is able to see that where no one else can. God is able to see the thoughts and the intents of Lucifer himself. Isaiah 14, "How art thou fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son of the morning? How art thou cut down to the ground, which didst weaken the nations? For thou hast said in thine heart." There it is right there. God knew what Lucifer was thinking in his heart, what he said to himself. "I will ascend into heaven. I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. I will sit also upon the mount of the congregation in the sides of the north. I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will be like Joseph Smith." No, that's not what he said. He didn't say that he would be like Buddha. He didn't say that he would be like the angel Moron Eye. He didn't say that he was going to be like Allah, because he's already that. That's who he is. He said, "I will be like the Most High." That's God's title. By the way, King James Pure Bible Search software, get this, purebiblesearch.com. Type in the phrase "Most High." No, that does not refer to a Woodstock concert, okay? Most High. Get your mind out of the gutter. Most High is God's name 49 times exactly in your King James Bible. 7 times 7. And the last thing that Lucifer says in Isaiah 14 is, "I will be like the Most High." Count those words. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Anyway, God is able to see into places that you and I cannot see. Psalm chapter 2 talks about a conspiracy. It talks about the kings, the rulers of this world, take counsel together against the Lord and against his anointed. Against God, against his Christ, his Messiah. Those of us who have put on Christ, I believe, are part of the, not part of the conspiracy against Christ, part of the conspiracy. How can I say this? We're not the ones against Christ. They are the ones who are against the Lord and his anointed, and us being in Christ are the recipients of that persecution, that conspiracy. Because what they said is, "Let us break their bands asunder and cast their cords from us." It's all about breaking things loose, letting things go. Let it go, let it go. That's what it's all about. It's all about unlocking something that's hidden, unleashing the beast. Here is the key to unlocking your inner success, or your inner hero, or your inner champion. Joel Osteen's theme: discover the champion in you. Only one time in the Bible the word champion's used, and it's in reference to Goliath. And that teaching is that there's something hidden inside of us, and it needs to be unleashed. We need to open the gate and unlock the door and let it out. At CERN, the Large Hadron Collider, God sees what this is. He knows what it is. The intentions that were in the heart of these that are gathered here around Shiva, who is surrounded by flames. Think about it. If you are, or if some, I'll say someone, if someone is surrounded by flames in the Bible, where do you think they would be? Would they be in heaven? No. Would they be on earth somewhere? No, not especially. Unless they were in Sodom. They would be in hell. That's what Shiva is doing. That's where Shiva is. That's where he is. Locked up, hidden, occulted. And he wants to be released. He wants to be let out. This article, the European Organization for Nuclear Research, CERN, nuclear, has launched an investigation into a video filmed at night on its Geneva campus depicting, now I'm going to correct this article. It says that it was depicting a mock ritual. Now, I don't agree with the wording. It was a ritual. Was it a human sacrifice? Interestingly enough, and I've watched the video. I don't know if there's more video than what I saw on the website. But according to what I saw, when the knife or the alleged knife was allegedly thrust into the chest cavity of this young lady dressed in all white, then the guy freaks out. He lets out a rather lengthy train of expletives that are beeped out. The camera's shaking all over the place, and that's it. My question is, did this really occur? Did a human sacrifice actually occur? Now, naturally, the people at CERN, and let's just think conspiracy for a minute. If there is a spiritual force at CERN, and I absolutely believe there is, and you're looking at a representation of it right there. John said, you have heard that Antichrist shall come. And he said, already there are many Antichrists. And he talked about the spirit of Antichrist, which already is. Every mystery religion, religions based upon an occult knowledge, a secret knowledge that is hidden in symbols and rituals. Every one of those mystery doctrines, mystery religions, point you in the direction of the beast, the man of sin, the son of perdition, the Antichrist, the idol shepherd. They all point you in that direction. And I absolutely believe that associated with every idol, and you're looking at, let me point it this way. I'm actually turning away from my screen, but I look like I'm turning toward my screen. You're looking at a depiction of a god, and I believe attached to every idol is a spirit and not a good one. There's actually, let's see here, there's actually scripture. If I were to put this up here on the screen here, devils. Let's see here. Look here. Deuteronomy 32:17. They sacrificed unto devils, not to God, to gods whom they knew not, to new gods that came newly up, whom your fathers feared not. Cue the music on that. I mean, that's like nailing it right there. I mean, look at that verse. They sacrificed unto devils. Let's go back and look at this image here. The video shows, and there's somebody, you know, you can sort of see the reflection of the room, this wherever this guy's standing. And he's watching these people do this weird thing in the middle of the night. They come out dressed in black robes, and they are in front of the image of Shiva. Then out steps this young lady dressed in white, opposites, black and white, and she lays down, and this guy, you can see an object in his hand. He bends down quickly and makes the motion of thrusting the dagger into this young lady, and then stands up, of course, her body laying there, and that's pretty much the end. It's at this point here that you hear the long string of expletives that have been beeped out. I mean, this guy went on for a long time. And then the camera starts shaking. That's the end of the video. That's as far as I've seen. Bring that passage. Bring that scripture back up there. They sacrificed unto devils, not to God, unto gods, little g, whom they knew not. These gods were idols, images. Dagon was one of them. They made one to Milcom, to Saturn, Chiun, Remphan, Baal. Baal was a calf or a bullock of some kind. And they would make these images. They would have some sort of ritual centered around worshiping this image. And that is precisely what is going on here. Exactly what's going on. There is a ritual being performed in Geneva, Switzerland, on the campus of CERN, the Large Hadron Collider. Anyway, they launched an investigation into a video filmed at night in its Geneva campus depicting a mock ritual human sacrifice, a spokeswoman said Wodensday. The bizarre video, which has circulated online for days, shows several individuals in black cloaks gathering in the main square at Europe's top physics lab in what appears to be a reenactment of an occult ceremony. It doesn't appear to be. It is. The video includes the staged stabbing of a woman. Let's see here. The bizarre video. I'm trying to make sure. These scenes. Here is a spokesman from CERN. Maybe I've got my pages. No, I got them right. These scenes were filmed on our premises, but without official permission or knowledge. Very interesting choice of words. A CERN spokeswoman told AFP in an email. Of course, there's not going to be some sort of inner office memorandum circulated throughout the CERN offices announcing the sacrifice of a white adorned virgin in front of the statue of Sheba. This will take place at 3:30 a.m. All of those who wish to attend, please wear all black. You're not going to find that anywhere. But here's something very interesting about the language that is coming from this spokeswoman of CERN. She said, CERN does not condone this type of spoof. Notice the language. Mock ritual. What else was said? It was a mock ritual. It was a staged stabbing. Now, again, I don't know that they actually killed this girl. I don't know that they actually stabbed her. Is it possible? Is it feasible? Could it have happened? There's no doubt in my mind. You need to understand how human beings work when and how they think when they are under the leadership or control of spirits. You may mock that. You may say, that's not possible. We make up our own mind. Well, let me tell you what the Bible says. In Ephesians chapter 2, Paul knew this. Paul dealt with a lot of people. Paul dealt with some very, very evil people. And he said in Ephesians chapter 2, you hath he quickened, who were dead in trespasses and sins. Whether they killed this girl or not, she's, according to the scripture, she is already dead in her trespasses, in her sins. This is the night of the walking dead here. These people, they are already once dead. The Bible speaks about the false teachers, false prophets, those who follow them in the last days, as being twice dead, which means that they have already been categorized by God as being the recipients of the second death, which is the lake of fire. They already have a train pulling up to the station, ready to take them to Fire Lake, where Damien Hellstrom lives. That's Marvel's comics, The Son of Satan. But anyway, the second verse of the second chapter of Ephesians, here's what it says right after that. Wherein in time past you walked according to the course of this world. This world is on course for something. It is driving toward an event, a certain day, a happening, a massive deception. Walked, you and I used to walk according to the course of this world. That's where you and I used to be. According to the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that now worketh in the children of disobedience. Prince of the power of the air. When I say that, what's the first thing that comes to your mind? And if you say chocolate, you need some chocolate, okay? The prince of the power of the air, the last airbender, elements, elemental witchcraft. There is, in if you know anything about Wicca, and I'm not talking about, you know, cartoon witchcraft, Bugs Bunny witchcraft, Witch Hazel. I'm talking about real Wicca, summer solstice worshiping witchcraft. Elemental witchcraft involving the elements of earth, wind, fire, and water. Those four elements. By the way, that's four. They're a replacement for Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. You have the absence of the gospel replaced by the only other religion that exists. There are two religions in the world, Bible Christianity and witchcraft. Witchcraft is identified as any kind of religious practice that involves and requires rituals, practices, certain magical power words, etc., etc., in order to invoke a god or a deity or a force of some kind. You must say the words. You must do the ritual. You must draw the circle. You must face north, south, east, and west. You must use this dagger with this chalice. By the way, there is a witchcraft ritual called the blade and the chalice. It involves a man and a woman represented as opposites. Look at those pictures. White and black, light and darkness, male, female, yin, yang, sons of God, daughters of men. She's dressed in a wedding dress, a wedding gown. Here comes the bride, all dressed in pink, open the window. You know the rest of it. But the Wicca ritual of the blade and the chalice, there are varying degrees of this ritual. The first one is, of course, where it's strictly ceremonial and symbolic. The woman will hold a cup representative of, like, the Holy Grail. She will hold the cup. A male member of this particular coven or participant of this ritual will have a dagger in his hand or some sort of blade or sword or something like that, and he will insert it into the cup. Now, there is, you guessed it, an adulterous meaning behind this. So that's the symbolic level of it. But there is another practice of this that involves actuality, where the woman herself is the cup, the grail, the one who holds the blood line, the wine, the elixir of life. And the male member and is the dagger. He is the sword. He is the, can't remember their word for it, but anyway, he is the dagger, the blade. And those two will fornicate in this ritual. There is another deeper level of this that actually involves a dagger and a ritual sacrifice. It's real. It exists. People die as a result of this. I have a friend, longtime friend, I've known him for years, who got off into the occult in a serious way, saw an event like this take place, told me a little bit about it. And I'm just going, that's crazy. You say, I don't believe that stuff anymore. Excuse me. In the Bible, God constantly reprimanded and then poured out his wrath upon Israel because they were making their children to, quote, pass through the fire. What was that in reference of? They were taking their offspring, their own bloodline, and sacrificing their children to Moloch, this beast god, and they would literally burn their own children with fire. They did this in order to appease the gods. Let's make the gods happy. Let's offer them a serious sacrifice so that we can get rain in harvest time and our crops will grow and all of this stuff. I read something on Facebook, one of these memes the other day, and I like it. It says, in Islam, you must sacrifice yourself for your God. In Bible Christianity, our God sacrificed himself for us. Can I get somebody to say amen? But there are two religions in the world. There's Bible Christianity and there's witchcraft. Because every other religion in the world, as my friend Reg Kelly said, there are two types of religion, do and done. Bible Christianity is done. Christ did it all for us, for our benefit. He sacrificed himself for our judicial blessing. The other religions of the world are all about you must do this, you must do that, you must perform this, you must perform that. That is, at its core, it is the idea of witchcraft. You cannot find in the Bible, especially the New Testament, where we are required to perform either a work of the law or say some sort of power words or magic words or recite this particular prayer. Even Jesus, when the disciples asked him, Lord, teach us to pray, he was not saying, now write these words down, because if you say these words, then you'll have magic powers. You'll have special powers. If you say these words correctly, then you'll get from God what you want. Hashtag prayer of Jabez. Remember that? The guy writes this book, says, I prayed this prayer 3 times a day, and now I'm rich. Well, of course he's rich. He wrote a book about it, sold it, millions of copies, fooled everybody into believing that if you said this prayer 3 times a day, you would be healthy and rich and good-looking. You would grow hair back on your head or whatever it is. It's witchcraft, nonsense. There's a spirit behind this. There is a spirit behind what's going on at CERN. And this ritual, to me, nails it. The article tries to make it out as a mockery, as a spoof, as an alleged incident. But here's the thing. She said the investigation underway was an internal matter. CERN does not condone this type of spoof, which can give rise to misunderstandings about the scientific nature of our work. Yes, we are all Vulcans. We're only doing this in the name of science. And we don't know why this statue of Shiva is out there. Which actually they do. They do know why. Because there is a large group of the scientists working at CERN that are from the nation of India, where Shiva is one of their main deities. Shiva is part of a Hindu trinity. Brahma, Shakti, you know who that is? Shakti is Shekinah. Shakti is Venus. Shakti is Ashtaroth. She is Persephone. She is all of these different female Diana, according to the scriptures, whom the whole world worshipeth. That's who Shakti is. She is Mystery Babylon the Great, the mother of harlots. And then you have Brahma, you have Shakti, and you have Shiva. That's their, from what I understand, that's part of their little trinity. And these Indian scientists noticed that the dance of Shiva mirrored or was a reflection or of the same pattern as these little quantum particles that they are observing with the Large Hadron Collider. And they said that's like the same thing here. And there exist in quantum mechanics, quantum physics, not only the relationship between Shiva, the God who is in a chamber on fire, and his dance. He's called the Lord of the Dance. There's not only relationship between particle physics and Shiva. There is a connection between the Big Bang Theory, which is, that's what they're looking for. They're looking for what they refer to as the God particle. Now, do you think that they just said, well, you know, let's just play like we, you know, there's this idea that a God created the universe, which we don't really believe. We just think it's the Big Bang. But there has to be, there's a missing element here. It's something we don't see of how this body of mass ended up exploding and becoming the universe that we have. So we're looking for the Higgs boson, the God particle, they call it. Well, here's the interesting thing. The idea of a God particle, the idea of a Big Bang, is exactly what mystic Jewish rabbis teach in the Kabbalah. They teach that the entire creation was contained in this little bitty bitty tiny teeny tiny point of infinite mass, and that too much of the radiance of God overloaded it, and it exploded everywhere, and it took this primordial atom, the Ein Sof, they call it, and he was exploded along with it, and little bits and pieces of him are all over the place, and you and I have a little piece of that God in us. It's called the divine spark. It is the God particle. While this spokeswoman is trying to say, we are strictly scientific here. We are Vulcans. We are logical. We have no emotions, and we don't worship any God. But the truth of it is, their principles and their concepts and their scientific knowledge mirrors exactly the mystery cults. One is related to the other. Paul called it science falsely so-called. The video has raised questions about security on CERN's campus. Asked to detail the security procedures surrounding access to the campus, the CERN spokeswoman said, CERN IDs are checked systematically at each entry to the CERN site, whether it is night or day. The people in the video are thought to have had access badges for the CERN site. Badges? We don't need no stinking badges. She further indicated that those responsible for the prank had access. But are you listening to this? It's a spoof. It's a mock. It's a, let's see here. The scenes were filmed on premises with the knowledge, misunderstandings, so on and so on. They call it a spoof. This article calls it a prank, a mock. It's just like they're overloading the story. Methinks thou dost protest too much. They're trying to overload the story with these adjectives to lead you to believe that this was a bunch of drunk college students having some sort. They decided that their spanking ritual wasn't enough, so let's go out, let's really do this thing right. Woo! That's what they're trying to get you to think. CERN welcomes every year thousands of scientific users from all over the world, and sometimes some of them let their humor. See, now it's funny. It's a spoof. It's a mock. It is a prank. Now it's a joke. They let their humor go too far. This is what happened on this occasion, the email said. The spokeswoman was not available to comment on the possible identity of those responsible. Geneva police told AFP that they had been in contact with CERN about the video, but were not involved in an official investigation. You know, get the police over there. CERN hosts machinery carrying out some of the world's most elaborate particle research, including an enormously powerful proton smasher, trying to find previously undiscovered particles. Now, I'm going to show you the connection here between CERN, the Large Hadron Collider, and the religion and the doctrine of witchcraft. We have, let me take a swig here of my iced tea. A couple years ago, I did a series called The Elements of Wrath. It's a four video Watchmen video broadcast set. And I was dealing with various aspects of witchcraft. And as I was putting together the notes and the script for this Watchmen broadcast, and I was studying the deities of witchcraft, according to the witches, they had a horned god. And I'm going to show you that in a little bit. That horned god had a name. You may want to take a wild guess as to what that one of the names of the horned god was. CERN. I'm not making it up. I'm going to show it to you. Anyway, here's what we're going to do. We have that on DVD, that four video set called The Elements of Wrath. And the information that I'm presenting to you today is much, much expanded. You're talking about probably six hours worth of teaching. And just today, in preparation for this, I mastered six CDs of that is the audio from this set. I'm being asked more and more to make CDs available. Because some of you apparently still live in the 80s and you're playing compact disc and you don't have anything to play the MP3 disc or anything like that. And I like it because people can copy these and give them out to other people. And no, I don't need a royalty payment for that. I don't. We want you to copy anything that you get from us. Put it up, make up your own YouTube channel and put our videos on your YouTube channel. You think I care? Well, I want you to do it. That's how much I care. Because I don't care how many dollar bills I get from the work I do. What I care about is people hearing the truth of the Word of God. Those of you know, I put scriptures in these. I mean, a lot of them. So here's what we're offering. If you call our office, 636-931-3999, or write us at PastorMikeOnline@gmail.com, or you, let's see, kingjamescode.org. No, wait a minute, that's not it. PastorMike@kingjamescode.org. There, I got it right. PastorMike@kingjamescode.org. Send a request in, or go to propheticresearchministry.com. There's an order form there. And if you call or write us, we'll send you the videos and we'll send you the six CDs. Now you're waiting for me to say, and this will be yours for your generous payment of three payments of $39.95 plus $20 postage and handling. We don't do that. Never have. Not since I've been doing a Watchman broadcast. We don't sell them. We never will sell them. So you call, you get the DVDs, you get the CDs along with it. I just mastered them today. These are the masters right here. We didn't even have time to reproduce them yet. But you'll get the audio from all of these videos. Some of them I had to split up. You're getting about 6 hours of teaching here. If you wish to make a donation to help us out with our expenses, we would appreciate it. You may want to consider giving a little extra because some people can't give anything. And we've never said, well, if you can't give us anything, then you get nothing. Never done that, never will. Also, it helps to support Watchman FM, 102.1 KBTR, Marilal, Kenya. Michael is in Kenya right now. And he will be traveling out to Samburu in the next few days. He will also be going to Turkana, the county, which is like a state, next to Samburu. And they're having sort of like a tri-county fair. The governor of Turkana has already asked us to open up a radio station in his county, Turkana. Because he wants the Mzungu preacher, which is me, he wants that preaching in his county. Because it's actually a more dangerous place than Samburu is. And he said, we need God in here to clean this up. We need the gospel preached. Bless his heart. How many elected officials do you hear talk that way? But they specifically asked for our radio station to be in that area. And for ever since we've opened the radio station up, we've operated that station on just offerings, period. We've tried to get, you know, a little ad revenue here and there from different, you know, like Safaricom, places like that, cell phone companies and so on. It's just never come about. Will it ever? I don't know. But for the time being, it's only supported by those who follow this ministry. So we appreciate it. And so anything that you give would go toward that, go toward the CDs or whatever. But anyway, you're going to want this, all right? All right, now, let me get to it here. Here's a couple things about CERN that I had accumulated in my notes. Let's see here. There is, at CERN, a device called Delphi. Now, it's not in use anymore, according to the article that I have, but they're still analyzing the data. Delphi was a detector used in the Large Electron-Positron Collider. Delphi was a particle physics experiment at the CERN lab in Geneva, Switzerland. It studied the products of electron-positron collisions at the LEP circular accelerator, working at the then highest energies in the world. Why did they choose the word Delphi? What is Delphi? Here's where it gets interesting. Here's the beginning of a connection. Delphi was the site of what was called the Oracle at Delphi. There was a temple at Delphi dedicated to the god of prophecy. No, it wasn't Tim LaHaye, okay? Yeah. The god of prophecy was Apollo. Slash Apollyon. Ring any bells? Revelation 9:11. 9:11. Think 9:11. It was a temple dedicated to the god of prophecy, Apollo. And at the Oracle of Delphi, you would come into the temple. You would be bringing your money or whatever it is you had, because you don't get jack from these people without paying the piper first. You got to bring in your offering. And when you do, then you can ask the Oracle, which was a woman priestess. A woman, think Mystery Babylon. She would then receive your gift. She would take your question or your request. Usually it's a question, because this is a god of prophecy. What's going to happen? Am I going to get married? Okay, or whatever. Should I kill my third child because he's left-handed? I think he's a witch. You know, stuff like that. The priestess would then go and beseech Apollo somehow, some way, with some ritual. And then this spirit, now hang on to your hat, reach down to your left, grab your seatbelt and buckle yourself in. The Oracle at Delphi was a group of women, like Vestal Virgins. These women all operated together in this circle. And when the priestess would implore the god Apollo, Apollyon, to tell us the future, tell us, we want a word of prophecy, we want a word of wisdom, we want a word of knowledge from you, oh great destroyer. Shiva, by the way, that's one of the names for Shiva's, destroyer. You see the connection? Let me put that back up on the screen. Let me tell you who that is. That's Apollo, people. Apollyon, the destroyer. That's who Shiva is. That is one of his names. And so then the spirit of prophecy would come down upon these women, priests, these virgins, and give them the message. Now, these women would begin to utter the answer of the destroyer in a language or a tongue that nobody knew. Are you catching this? Because I'm throwing it in pretty hard. They were speaking in unknown tongues. They were speaking, are you get ready? They were speaking in a language that, according to John D was into scrying. He was into peering down into a mirror or a scrying bowl or a body of water. From the Lord of the Rings, the mirror of Galadriel. They would peer down in it and see visions. John D was visited by familiar spirits. These familiar spirits told him that the angels had a secret language that nobody knew. And that secret language God gave to Adam, and Adam used it to create all of the, like the animals and stuff like that. By the way, that is a teaching in the Word Faith movement. Jesse Duplantis taught that God gave Adam the creative ability, that when God commissioned Adam to name the animals, he wasn't just giving them a name. I see a horsey and a piggy and a little kitty cat and a little fishy. He wasn't just naming them. They were inanimate objects, And Adam, by speaking to them, was giving them life. That is what Jesse Duplantis taught. I'm not making that up. He made it up. I'm not making it up. But these spirits told John Dee, we angels sprechen a different Deutsch than you do. We habla a different Espanol, whatever. We speak a different tongue than you. And you, nobody on the earth knows this language, knows this tongue. That, my friends, is in your Bible. Do you want to know where? Deuteronomy 28. God said, as a result of not following after his laws and keeping all of his laws and statutes and judgments, that God would send the nation from afar, a nation of fierce countenance, a nation that flies swift as the eagle, a nation whose tongue thou shalt not understand. Are you catching this? Because in churches all over the world, there are people who are uttering, some of them are just going, that's what I heard the lady behind me 20 some odd years ago. I was at the Pentecostal church. I was looking, I've talked about this before, but the woman behind me, she was going like that. And the Holy Ghost is saying, Mike, you know, that's not anything, right? You know, she just making that up, don't you? Yeah. So Mike, if she's making this up, that means that I'm not in her. Yeah, I get that. God dealt with me about that. Now, I have pastors who are, as far as I'm concerned, brethren. I've met some of them in Kenya. I've met some of them here in the United States. They are the old-time Pentecostals. Many of them believe the King James, the Word of God, Joseph Chambers, Paul Creek Ministries. Others out there that have talked to me, and I have great respect for these men. What they do in their churches, they do it according to the Word of God. 1 Corinthians 14. If any man speak in an unknown tongue, let it be by two or at the most three, and let one interpret, one translate. And the guy told me, he said, Mike, that's just how we do it in our church. There cannot be a bunch of women doing this, and we cannot have this mayhem of people speaking in tongues everywhere. It is by two or at the most three, and that by course, and let one interpret. But if there be no interpretation, then everybody has to sit down and keep their mouth shut. I had a pastor in Kenya ask me the question, Pastor, and he was asking me about the use of tongues, and he was quoting scripture for me, and the Holy Ghost said, Mike, don't go after him. And I didn't. I said, Brother, let me tell you something. Let me tell you why I like you. You use scripture to back up your belief. I can't destroy you. I can't try to go after you over that simply because I don't agree with it. We all see through a glass darkly. And so I didn't try to just destroy the man and try to come out on top like King of the Hill because he was following in his conscience, he was following scripture. And I'm all for that. But you guys know what I'm talking about. You have experienced this. You know what it is. They claim and they boast and they brag that they speak a tongue that no one understands and they give no interpretation of it. And they say, get ready, they say, well, we're speaking the tongues of angels. Right? Enochian language is what they told John Dee. These oracles at Delphi would speak in this unknown tongue, and only the priestess knew the interpretation of it. Now, just think about the con here, the gimmick, the scam, the scheme, okay, the sting. Think about it. You give this woman money and say, tell me what I want to hear. That's what a harlot is. That's what a harlot does. Harlot will tell you whatever you want to hear. You pay enough money for it. So whether it was done by spiritual forces or not, that's still witchcraft, mystery, Babylon the Great. So they name this proton smasher at CERN, Delphi. Delphi is named after Apollyon, who is also Shiva. Same God, different names, Antichrist. Here's some other things about CERN that you should be concerned about. That's pretty good, wasn't it? Let's see here. CERN is the world's biggest machine, blah, 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 blah. CERN has a massive gravitational pull. So did I about 90 pounds ago. Yeah, seriously. Since January 25th, 90.5 pounds have come up missing from my body. I have no idea where it went. If you are considering, I'm not a salesman, I'm not a spokesman, what I did may not be for you, but if you have ever considered bariatric surgery and wasn't sure if it was right for you, I had a sleeve gastrectomy, it's what it's called, in January 25th of this year. I have a working stomach, works just like yours, it's just not very big. No, I don't have some plastic ring choking everything. I don't have that. That is a lap band. And those things, they don't work very well. But I had a sleeve gastrectomy. I was in very bad physical health. I weighed 321 and a half pounds and tried to lose weight all last year. Could not do it. And, I mean, I'm just at that age. And since I've had this, again, 90 and a half pounds I've lost. I do not have the blood sugar level of someone who has diabetes. In fact, on three different occasions now in the past month, I've had low blood sugar. Okay? Which means I am producing plenty of insulin. So diabetes is not an issue with me anymore. I used to have very severe sleep apnea and wear a CPAP. I do not wear that any longer. And I'm doing just fine. So there's a list of things that have taken place with me that I am far better off than I've ever have been. And for those of you who would criticize that, I want to be nice, but I'm telling you, you can't judge people whose 320 pound shoes you have not walked in. And what cinched it for me was the Bible says, put a knife to thy throat if thou be a man given to appetite. I was a man given to appetite. And I put a knife, or I had a doctor put a knife right here at the lower part of my throat. Because that's what they did. So anyway. Massive gravitational pull. CERN generates extreme temperatures. Stephen Hawking is worried about CERN. He said the God particle found by CERN could destroy the universe, Hawking wrote in the preface to a book called Starmus, a collection of lectures by scientists. The Higgs boson could become unstable at very high energy levels and have the potential to trigger a catastrophic vacuum decay, which could cause space and time to collapse, and we would not have any warning to the dangers. Again, this doesn't come from some sort of wacky, weird, sensationalist, clickbait website. It doesn't come from there. It comes from Stephen Hawking, a man who understands Higgs bosons and quarks and quantum stuff and what they're doing. He gets it. And he's saying the God particle has the potential. Now, I want to digest what he said. The God particle has the potential to destroy things. You get it? That's what Hawking said. I don't know if he was in between stripper bars. Do you remember that? Hawking, whoever runs him around, he was having his drivers take him to strip clubs. Not making that up. Let's see here. Opening the door to other dimensions. Now, I want you to take this seriously. 1 year after CERN's grand opening, Sergio Bertolucci, former director for research and scientific computing of the facility, grabbed headlines when he told a British tabloid the super collider could open otherworldly doors to another dimension. Dimension of sight and sound and mind. You're in the Twilight Zone. He said it could open another dimension for a very tiny lapse of time. Lapse of time. Mere fractions of a second. You know what he just said? Time warp. However, that may be just enough time, quote, to peer into this open door either by getting something out of it or sending something into it. I want you to think of the ramifications of this statement. Again, this is not from some whacked out, when I say clickbait, you see this stuff pop up on Facebook, you see it all over the internet, and they want you to click the article. And you go to their article, you're surrounded now by 20 or 30 advertisements, and the article is only four paragraphs long, but you got to read it in segments. You got to click for every new paragraph. That's because new ads roll up, and whoever does this gets paid. This is not coming from that. This is coming from the guys who are part of this particle physics movement going on, saying to us, number one, it could destroy the entire universe. Number two, we're talking about opening a portal and warping or penetrating the barrier of the space slash time continuum. Is it even possible? Is it in the Bible? Yeah, it is. CERN's curious choice of geographic location. Check this out. And I've got another one to add to it here in a little bit. Now, on top of all the speculation as to what CERN scientists are really attempting to do with their Large Hadron Collider, many observers could not help but notice that the town in France where CERN is partially situated is called St. Genis Pouilly. The name Pouilly, P-O-U-I-L-L-Y, pardon my French, comes from the Latin. Are you ready for this one? Cue the music. Comes from the Latin, Apoliacum. And it is believed that in Roman times, a temple existed in honor of Apollo. And the people who lived there believed that it is a gateway to the underworld. Sorry. It is interesting to note that CERN is built on the same spot where existed at one time a temple to the destroyer. Is this starting to make sense to you now? Are you going, look, Hoggy, it was a bunch of drunk scientists putting on black robes, ceremonial robes, which they probably got at the CERN masquerade party. They were drunk. They talked this hippie chick into wearing this white ritual dress. They had a butter knife. And that was just, there's nothing to it. Do you start to see things coming together here? We've not even touched the scriptures as far as this is concerned, although Revelation 9:11, I want you to turn there. I did another video called The Beast of 9:11. That goes back a few years. You can get that one as well, along with Elements of Wrath is the DVD series. You get the DVDs, you get the CDs. And you can ask for, what did I just say? The Beast of 9/11. In Revelation chapter 9, verse 11, and they had a king over them, which is the angel of the bottomless pit, whose name in the Hebrew tongue is Abaddon, but in the Greek tongue hath his name Apollyon. CERN is the location of the ancient temple dedicated to Apollyon, the destroyer. And it just so happens that one dark night, there was a ritual performed at this site in front of this statue in a ceremonial fashion, offering a sacrifice to a deity. And people think, there's nothing to that. That's just... Number four, things that CERN is doing, tapping into what's called dark matter. Astonishing astrophysical observations have demonstrated that all visible physical matter accounts for only 4% of the universe. Now the race is on at CERN to find those elusive particles or phenomena responsible for what's called dark matter and dark energy. Now, if that doesn't grab you scripturally, spiritually, read John chapter 1. Jesus is the light that shines into a dark place, but the dark comprehends it not. There is that light, and that light is Jesus Christ, and there is darkness. There are rulers of the darkness of this world. That's part of what you and I are wrestling with. Rulers of the darkness of this world. And at CERN, they are trying to discover dark matter and dark energy. The word vril comes to mind, V-R-I-L. I've talked about that before too. Supposedly, this unknown energy force that is ruled over and possessed by a nation of people that live under the surface of the earth. Vril. It is believed that Adolf Hitler was aware of this story. He had a group of people. They were in contact with familiar spirits. They were called the Thule Society, T-H-U-L-E. Thule was they believed that it was a city that was, you had to go to the North Pole to get there, Santa Claus, and Arcturus, the Arctic Circle, Thule, there's another word for it. I can't remember what it is. But anyway, the United Nations logo is centered upon this exact spot. And they believed that there was a race of like supermen, Aryans, that lived in this city below the surface of the earth. Access was at the North Pole. That's what they believed. The center point of the circle of the earth. That's what they believed. Dark energy, dark matter. There are spirits that are, here's what I believe. There are spirits who are dark energy. They are the opposite of light. They are not Christ. They are anti-Christ. The CERN logo, sixes all over it. The deity of destruction as a corporate mascot. Although most corporations shun any connection with religion and the spiritual world, CERN has chosen as its mascot a Hindu goddess. I think that Shiva is actually androgynous, I think. In fact, I'm pretty sure. Just outside of its headquarters building sits an ancient statue to Shiva, ancient Apollyon, the goddess of destruction. Okay? Those are some things about CERN. Things you should be concerned with. Let's bring God into it. Not just a particle of God, Let's bring God into this. Let's understand a little bit about witchcraft, Wicca, these strange rituals, etc., etc. From a book or an article called What Does It Mean to Be Wiccan? The article says, to be Wiccan is to worship the goddess and her companion, the horned god. Think Revelation 13. And I stood upon the sand of the sea, and I saw a beast rising up out of the sea, having seven heads and 10 horns. They worship the goddess and her companion, the horned god. Think Apollyon. Think the beast. And to follow the philosophies, ethics, and practices of the old religion. Very interesting choice of words. Originally rooted in paganism, Wicca existed long before Christianity and long before the church was founded. They're trying to claim here that we were first, we're the real religion, Christianity is a dupe. All right, that's what they're trying to claim here. Wiccans honor the earth as their spiritual mother, the goddess, and the sky and the wildness of nature, think about it, beast, as their spiritual father, who is the horned god. Here are depictions of him. Here is the horned god. Here is the goddess. And see the fire, the flames. Here is another depiction of him as a 10-point buck. You see him all throughout England, Europe. They're everywhere. The green, Jack on the Green, or the Green Man, or the Horned Man, or Pan. Infinite number of names that this god goes by, but we know who it is. It is the man of sin. It is a beast with seven heads and 10 horns. There is actually a witchcraft museum. I think this is in England. And they have a statue, a depiction of their horned god, who just happens to look like a guy, girl named Baphomet, who is a destroyer. He is a he is an androgynous god. He is male and female. He is yin and yang, positive and negative, sun and moon, light and darkness. He is a destroyer and a builder simultaneously. Yeah, he wears the pentagram. There's a connection with the number 5 here. Remember what Lucifer said. I will be like the Most High. He said 5 different things in that statement. He's called the horned god, the hairy man of the forest, the green man, the mighty hunter. What does that sound like to you? Genesis chapter 10. Now we're going to bring God into this. God is the one who sees all of the mystery religions. He knows what it is they believe, what they practice, what they are trying to occult, which means what they are trying to hide, what they're trying to keep secret. They don't want anybody to find out. It cannot be revealed yet. In Genesis chapter 10, verse 6, the sons of Ham, Cush and Mizraim and Phut and Canaan. How many sons? 1, 2, 3, 4. Cush and Mizraim. Mizraim is the Egyptians, I believe. And Phut and Canaan. The sons of Cush, Seba, Havilah, and Sabta, and Reama, and Sabtika. The sons of Reama, Sheba, and Dedan. Those are mentioned in Ezekiel 38, who are in a league with Gog, the chief prince. And Cush begat Nimrod. Interestingly enough, Nimrod is the 13th in the line from Adam. If you remember in the book of Jude, Jude specifically pointed out that Enoch was the 7th from Adam. Why is that germane? Why is that necessary? Why is it that the Bible and the writer of the Bible, Jude in this case, why is it, and the Holy Spirit, holy men of God spake as they were moved by the Holy Ghost. Why is it that the Holy Spirit seemed it significant enough to tell you not only what Enoch said, but who he was and what number he was. 7. Enoch, the 7th from Adam. I think, number one, it relates to a sure word of prophecy, the number 7 being the number for perfection. The words of the Lord are pure words, as silver tried in a furnace of earth, purified 7 times. Naaman dipped in the River Jordan 7 times, purified himself of his leprosy. Genesis, God finished his work in 7 days, and he hallowed and sanctified the 7th day. He purified it. And so that's what that number 7 represents. It also represents the purification of God's word. It's pure. It's perfect. It also represents completion. 7 days, and that's it. It's over with. The 8th day is the number for new life, new beginnings, things like that. But we have Nimrod. If you count the numbers, count the lineage, Noah is 10. Ham is 11. Cush is 12. Nimrod is 13. Think Revelation 13. Think Acts 13. Deuteronomy 13. Revelation 13. Mystery Babylon the Great, the mother of harlots and abominations of the earth. 13 words. 13 times they marched around Jericho. 13 times. One time a day for 6 days. 7 times on the 7th day. Go to a King James Bible. Go to Genesis 13:13 and count the number of words in that verse and then look at what it says. Okay? I'm just going to leave it there. Cush begat Nimrod. Nimrod began to be a mighty one in the earth. He was a mighty hunter. That's who this is. A mighty hunter going after the prey, devouring the souls of men. He was a mighty hunter before the Lord, wherefore it is said, even as Nimrod, the mighty hunter before the Lord. And the beginning of his kingdom was 1, 2, 3, 4. Babel's at the beginning of that. 4 cities in the land of Shinar. It's now referred to as Sumeria. What is it? Zechariah Sitchin has written several books on the Sumerian cults and the Sumerian religious ideas, the idea of a race of superior beings coming down to the earth and mating with human women and so on. And the funny thing is, Sitchin believes that the Sumerian count is the real and true account, and the Bible's account is the corrupted form of that. Okay, he's got it all backwards. He's the 6th son of Cush. That's who Nimrod is. He's 13th from Adam, and he makes 4 cities. Think Esau. Genesis 25. Think about this. God tells Rachel, you've got 2 sons in your womb, but 2 manner of nation. They're not identical twins. They're opposites. One I love, one I hate. Think about it. Think about a child being born. You have Jesus, who is the beloved Son of God. You have the Son of God, Jesus. You have a son of the gods, Antichrist, son of perdition, the beast, son of Belial, child of the devil. Words like that. So here's a son, here's 2 sons being born. One God loves, one God hates. And the one that God hates, look at it. The first came out all red, all over like an hairy garment. Now ask the question. When you think of the color red, what do you think? Number one, blood, okay. Though your sins be as what? Scarlet. They should be white as snow. Though they be red like crimson. When the woman comes in riding the beast, what color is that beast? Red. Look at Esau again. The first came out red all over like an hairy garment, and they called his name Esau. Now, there is a genetic disorder. called, I think it's called hypertrichosis. I remember this from my days back reading Ripley's Believe It or Not and the Guinness Book of World Records. I used to just love that stuff. Jojo the dog boy, hypertrichosis. There are people that are born with a genetic disorder and literally they grow hair like fur. And it doesn't do any good to shave it off because, I mean, it just comes right back. I would assume that Esau had this genetic trait. But I want you to think of what his appearance is. He was red all over like a hairy garment. When Jacob went in to deceive his father Isaac, pretending to be Esau, what did he do? He took goat skin with the fur on it, strapped it to his arm and hands, and when his father said, "Hey, you sound like Jacob. I need to come on over here, my son." And he feels him. He's going, "No, you're Esau. That's Esau." He had fur all over him. What was he a picture of? The beast. And God hates him. And after that came his brother out, and his hand took hold on Esau's heel. And his name was called Jacob, and Isaac was 80 years old when she bare them, 60. And the boys grew, and Esau was a cunning hunter. Look there. A man of the field, and Jacob was a plain man dwelling in tents. Two opposite guys. Okay? God loved one, Jacob. He hated the other, Esau. Esau is a type, a foreshadow, a picture of a child to be born who is a mighty hunter, a beast. Let me move through some of this. Jacob, have I loved? Esau, have I hated? Romans 9, 11, 12, and 13. Now here is the horn god. To the Celts, or the Celts, the horn god was known by names such as Cernunnos, or Cern, or Bela Tukadros. Look at that word, Bela Tukadros. I don't know how to pronounce that. It has the word bell in it. Now, that doesn't mean ding dong, pizza's here. Bell is Baal. It's another form of the word Baal. It was depicted as a humanoid figure who was more commonly depicted as having stag-like antlers rather than true horns. One of the Cernunnos titles was Lord of the Hunt. But as time progressed, agriculture could sustain alongside hunting, and the horn god became the god also of a broader fertility. Worship of this deity was hoped to not only maintain plentiful meat, but also to ensure a bountiful crop harvest and even the successful procreation of mankind. There are some tribes in the Far East, in some of the Polynesian islands, that at when it's time to plant their crops, they actually have young ladies and young men go out into the field and fertilize. That's all I'm going to say. But anyway, that's part of their wickedness. That's part of their fornication. Mystery Babylon, who is the mother of harlots. But anyway, Cernunnos has also been associated to the underworld, the realm of the dead. Think about it. That's who Shiva is. That's who Apollo is. He is a god of the underworld, god of the dead. Whilst the God is not, and Jesus said it, exact words, God's not the god of the dead. There's another god for that. He's the god of the living. The god of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Whilst the invading Romans could associate the horn god with some of their own belief concepts, such as the deity Pan or the horn spirits called fauns or satyrs, that's mentioned in your Bible. A satyr is a hairy devil. That's what it is. It is a spirit. And God said this, that as a result of Babylon and her wickedness and the wickedness of his people, that wild beasts are going to inhabit. Dragons are going to live in their palaces, and satyrs shall dance there. What does Shiva do? Does a dance. Satyrs. The developing Christian church, however, could not comfortably assimilate this fertility icon into their own ethos, so Cernunnos was demonized. Thus, the horned god became the horny devil. But his name is CERN. According to Sabina Magliacco, Gerald Gardner says in the 1959 book, The Meaning of Witchcraft, that the horned god is an undergod. Look at this. A mediator between an unknowable supreme deity and the people. In Wiccan liturgy, in the Book of Shadows, this conception of an unknowable supreme deity is referred to as, I have no idea how to pronounce that word, Dryghtyn, Dryten. It is not a personal god, but rather an impersonal divinity similar to the Tao of Taoism. Tao is a religious philosophy that worships or taps into a deity that doesn't have an exact depiction or description. An unknown god. That's what Tao is. And by the way, Taoism is a religion of prophecy, just like Apollo is. But the horned god is a mediator between an unknowable supreme deity. I know who it is. It's not the Most High. The Most High God actually already has his own mediator. And there is one mediator between man and God, or between men and God, the man, Christ Jesus. Now think of the opposite here. You have the Most High God who has as a mediator between men, mankind, and God, the man, Christ Jesus. Flip it over upside down, turn it 180 degrees. You have one who wants to be like the Most High, who has his own mediator, but he's not a man. He's a beast. And his name is CERN. Where did they get that? Now, one of the things I read about CERN, it's the Center for something. Research. Okay? CERN is supposed to be like an anagram. C-E-R-N represents what the name of it is. But do you think that a spirit working in the children of disobedience had anything to do with how or what this magic circle was named? Of that, I have no doubt. Now, I wasn't in on the meeting. I didn't see the secretary's notes where they decided that they would honor the supreme deity or the mediator, Cernunnos. They would honor this by naming their research facility after him. I don't have those notes in front of me. I wasn't there in the meeting. Couldn't find it on the internet. But I know a God who is in on every meeting. He listens to all of the people in the world getting together behind closed doors. The Holy Spirit is always at the Bilderberg meeting. Always. God knows, the Word of God knows everything about everybody. Knows all the secrets. So it doesn't surprise me that these connections are there, and there are even connections that are being made by those who run CERN. By the way, here is what's called the I Ching. I Ching the mighty. No, that's not what I meant. It's called the I Ching. It is the religion of Tao. And here's what's interesting. You have earth, air, fire, and water. You have the four elements. You have a funny combination of dots and dashes. Notice that. You have a dash, dot, dot, dash, dot, 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 dash, 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 dot, dot, dash, dot, dot. Notice that these are all different. And they are in segments of three. And there's just this little bit I know about the I Ching. I Ching the body electric. Let's see. Here, I should have a sound effect that goes with I Ching. Here we go. I Ching. That's pretty good, wasn't it? Okay. So that's going to be my sound effect for I Ching. There's an interesting correlation between what you see here in this symbol. And I have not talked about this because I have not studied Taoism to any degree to where I could understand it well enough. But there is something that I know. And I don't quite understand the meaning of it. But the I Ching of Tao, and that's what you're looking at here, this is an oracle. It is a prophetic oracle. Those who are into this practice will do something with this I Ching thing in order to get a prophecy of the future. Here's what's really interesting. See these dots and dashes here? They're divided into subgroups of three. There's three here. Three here, three here, three here, and so on and so on. Notice that they are merely dashes or lines and dots. Morse code is dashes and dots. Now, I don't think that Samuel Morse studied the I Ching and came up with Morse code that way. I don't believe that. Here's what I do believe. That you're actually looking here, when you're looking at this graphic, you're looking at an ancient occult representation of DNA. And I'll show you how. You know that, where's my DNA model? It's downstairs. Hang on a second. Fortunately, I have a DNA tie. Okay? I'm going to put my earpiece back in so I can hear the music at the end of the program. Here's my DNA tie. Okay? Notice that in DNA, you have two rungs that make the ladder, and you have base pairs that connect to one another. Okay, see that? If it's adenine on this side, it's thymine on this side. If it's guanine on this side, it's cytosine on that side. Okay? So think of the adenine-thymine joining as, let's say, a line or a dash, and the guanine-cytosine joining as a dot. Because essentially, that's the language of DNA. It's like a binary language. And in order for the base pairs to make an amino acid, which is the letter of like the book of DNA. Remember, there's 22 amino acids. There is 22 letters in the Hebrew alphabet. In order to make an amino acid or a letter of the alphabet in DNA, you have to have three bases joined together in any one of multiple combinations. Let's say adenine, guanine, and guanine here. Okay? And it's always in triplets. Always. Whenever you have, well, let me correct that. There's like one or two instances where it's not. They just found that out. But to make a letter of the DNA alphabet, you have to have three of these together. That's what happened? I hit the wrong button. That's what you have here. You have basically a representation of three bases combining to make an amino acid, a letter. And in the I Ching, there are a total of 64 possible combinations of lines or dashes or dots, excuse me. In DNA, when you have those triplet sets, there is exactly 64 different combinations of them to make one amino acid or one letter of the alphabet. How did the ancient Taoists come up with this? How did they do that? Because we don't know that DNA is coded by triplet base pairs joined together in 64 different combinations. We don't know that before the 20th century and the 21st century. Nobody knows that. And yet here it is. By the way, this is a DNA representation, not of any ordinary human. A white and dark human. A human who is on and off. A creature who is not yet is. A dark room that is well lit. It's the balance of opposites, all right? I just thought I'd throw that in there. Why was I talking about this? Anyway, moving right along. Here's another one. Here's another representation of this horned god, Amon Zeus. He has horns like a ram. He is the deity. He is the mediator between an unknown... Oh, that's why I was talking about Tao and Taoism. And that's what that is. The I Ching is a representation, I think, of the DNA of the man of sin, the son of perdition. Okay? I'll study it more, but that's what I know so far. The neo-pagan tradition of Stregeria, founded by Raven Grimassi and based on the works of Charles Godfrey Leland, the horned god goes by several names, including Dionysus, Faunus, CERN, and Acteon. His name is CERN, people. That's not by mistake. Just like this, it's not an accident that this is an exact model of how the base pairs come together and form the amino acids, the letters of DNA. That's not an accident. There was a spirit involved in this. There is a spirit involved in this. There is a spirit involved in this right here in CERN. And this number just happens to be 666. That's what his number is. There's Shiva. This is the exact location where this mockery, this buffoonery, this little fake little thing that they did, this play, they were acting out a play. That's what it was. They were making a horror movie. Okay? That's what the spokeswoman wants everybody to believe, that this was no big deal. We didn't actually kill a person. This wasn't actually a real ritual. It was all fake. It was all staged. It was all just tomfoolery is what it was. Little too much vodka. That's what they want you to think. But it doesn't matter if they were drunk or not. And I'll tell you this. It doesn't even matter that the people who were participating in this ritual actually believed that what they were doing was honoring or appeasing a god of some kind. And I'll tell you what I mean by that. Bible Christianity is different than every other religion in the world for one reason. That reason is, in Bible Christianity, in order to please God, there is only one, and I repeat, only one thing required by man to please God. Hebrews 11:6. Without faith, it is impossible to please God. The doctrine of the new covenant is we are saved by grace through faith or belief. I've heard from some people who say, I believe that if you only believed in God one day and asked God to save you and you were an unbeliever the rest of your life, you're still going to inherit heaven. That's not what the Bible says. There is no verse that says that ever anywhere in the Bible. The quintessential, the absolute essence and the essential thing that must be in place in my life in order for me to attain the blessings and the gifts of God is I have to believe him. I have to believe what he said. Did you know that the devil does not require belief? He does not require belief. He does not, because witches, right? Witches worship Satan. We know they do. Ask a witch. No, I'm not talking about your wife either. Ask, and or your mother-in-law, okay? Or your Aunt Hazel, okay? Or anybody like that. Ask a witch, do you believe in the devil? They'll say, no, we don't believe in the devil. That's, man made the devil up. We don't believe in a devil like that. We don't believe, what we're doing is not evil. We're good witches. We wear white clothes. We only practice good magic. They don't believe in the devil, and yet they worship him by their rituals and their practice. What I'm saying to you is, there's one religion that actually requires faith and nothing else from its adherents, from its followers, Bible Christianity, and every other religion in the world does not require correct, true belief. All it requires is ritual and the pronunciation of certain words or phrases or spells. And so these people standing out in front of the destroyer God, king of the underworld, the people who are doing this ritual don't even have to actually believe that they're worshiping Satan or that they're worshiping the Antichrist. Doesn't matter. They can believe anything they want or not believe at all. But they're still doing it. They're still performing the ritual in order to appease the God or the deity. Look at there. Cue the music. Come on. Now, why do you think Newsweek used that image? Is it because Obama himself is the Antichrist? No, I don't believe that. Yeah, well, on their website, they actually had the words of Jesus pronounced in Aramaic, and he said, Barack Obama. Don't listen to that garbage, okay? Don't fall for that nonsense, people. Obama does not have 7 heads and 10 horns. He is, however, and I'm speaking from, I don't even know if I should say this or not. He represents something. I'll say this. He represents fusion of opposites. That's who Obama represents. Newsweek has him as the God of all things, and they have him acting exactly like Shiva. That's how they depicted him in this. I'm just looking at this, and I'm just going, that's absolutely crazy. Revelation 9:11, they had a king over them, which is the angel of the bottomless pit, which is what I used to refer to my stomach as. As a bottom. A very shallow bottom. My stomach is the size of a banana. Okay? You know what it'll hold? A banana. What's wrong with you? They had a king over them, which is the angel of the bottomless pit, whose name in the Hebrew tongue is Abaddon, but in the Greek tongue hath his Leon. Now, I noted this here a while back. Hebrew has 22 letters. Greek has 24 letters. Together, it's 46. You say, what is that 46? 46 chromosomes. In the human genome, where our DNA is, 46 individual packages that where our the book of our DNA is stored. The tabernacle in the wilderness, the one that Moses built, God specifically told him. 20 boards down the north side, 20 boards down the south side, 6 boards across the back or western side. The front of it toward the east does not have any boards. It has pillars and a curtain. So Moses, by inspiration of God, built a tabernacle that has 46 boards in it, and inside that tabernacle was the book written in 22 letters, a rolled up book like a scroll, just like DNA is in the 46 chromosomes inside the nucleus of the cell. And the cell is the tabernacle, the temple. This next week's Watchmen broadcast, if you've not seen this new part of it yet, the body, the tabernacle, and what else? And the gospel. It is. I put the finishing touches on the script yesterday, and I just love it. I loved going through that study. Part 2 coming this weekend. But anyway, the cell, the human cell, is a depiction of the wilderness tabernacle and vice versa. And inside that cell is the nucleus. That is the sanctuary, the most holy place. And in the most holy place, you had the rolled up book written in 22 amino acid letters, surrounded by 46 boards. The temple that Solomon built, he erected it same fashion. It's got a wall around it, a membrane. It's got a nucleus. It's got a most holy place, 2 pillars that are holding up the structure of that temple. One called Jachin, one called Boaz, and they are each 23 cubits tall, exactly, 46. When that temple was destroyed, they built another one after the Babylonian exile. King Herod went in and remodeled the whole thing, so they called it Herod's Temple. But in John, Jesus said, destroy this temple, in 3 days I'll rebuild it. And they said, 40 and 6 years we're rebuilding this temple. Are you kidding me? 46 years, the temple. The 46th book of your Bible is 1 Corinthians. You know what it says in 1 Corinthians about 3 or 4 times? Know you not that your body is the temple of God? Ye are the temple of God. Ye are the temple of the living God. 46th book of the Bible. So the Hebrew letters and the Greek letters combined together. Apollyon, Abaddon, 46 letters exactly. There's a connection. I'm setting you up for something that I may not be able to get to today, but I'm setting you up for something. You're gonna like this. And if you can't wait, okay, call us, 636-931-3999. Get the Elements of Wrath DVDs. Get the audio CDs, 6 of them, okay? We'll send it to you. The Hindu deity Shiva. This is that statue there. They're going to talk about it. A 2-meter statue styled on kola bronzes of the deity engaging in the Nataraja dance of Chidambaram, paralleling the movements or dance of subatomic particles. The sculpture is usually made in bronze with Shiva dancing in an aureole of flames, a circle of flames. Think about it. I fell into a what? Burning ring of fire. Where did Johnny Cash get that song? Do you know? This is true. I don't know who wrote the Ring of Fire song. I don't know if it's Cash or somebody. But the night before, Johnny Cash was going to go to the studio to start recording his song, Ring of Fire. If I were to say, what is remarkable about the song, Ring of Fire? What stands out to you the most about that song? The Mexican trumpets. They're all throughout that song. Did you know that Johnny Cash had a dream the night before he goes into the studio to record that song? He has a dream, and in that dream he hears the song, and he has this little Mexican trumpet mariachi band playing that theme. That's where he got it from. Got it from a dream. All right. Anyway, Ring of Fire. Lifting his leg, or in rare cases, the right leg. Balancing over a demon or dwarf who symbolizes it is a well-known sculptural symbol in India and popularly used as a symbol of Indian culture. The two most common forms of Shiva's dance are the lasya, the gentle form of dance associated with the creation of the world. See, Shiva is a creator-destroyer. He's opposite. And the tandava, the violent and dangerous dance associated with the destruction of weary world views. Weary perspectives and lifestyles. I think whoever wrote this is trying to gloss over. I think the real understanding of those who follow Shiva, he's not just a destroyer of bad ideas. He is death, the destroyer of worlds. He doesn't just destroy bad movies, bad ideas, bad jokes. He destroys worlds, people. In essence, the lasya and the tandava are just two aspects of Shiva's nature, for he destroys in order to create, tearing down to build again. Let me show you something. Let me get back to this right here. You see Baphomet? Salve coagula. Salve means to dissolve or to destroy. Coagula means to coagulate or build back up. Shiva is. That's who CERN is. That's who Apollo is. You see the connection? There is a game on Google Android Marketplace called Shiva, the Time Bender. And you play this game, Shiva. You're the mighty Shiva. And you can live in one of four different time areas. The dinosaur time, space age, whatever. And you know how, and I'm going to admit something to you. There's only a couple games that I've ever played on computer. Okay. Castle Wolfenstein. Both versions, Half-Life 2, and this has been a while back, okay? When I play video games on my PC, I always play in what they call God mode. I hate getting killed in a game and having to start all over again. So I just cheat. In the Shiva Time Bender game, if you get bumped off, you can reverse time and do it all over again. There was a movie, Tom Cruise, where the world is invaded by this alien species. Cruise finds out that this alien species has the ability to reset time. The mother of, I kind of give it a feminine figure. I don't know if it's ever mentioned in the movie, but the mother of this alien species is called the Omega. She sends out these creatures called alphas. Get it? Alpha and Omega? These alphas go roaming around, and as the other, they call mimics, are fighting the humans on the battlefield, if the humans win the battle, at the end of the day, the alpha reports to the Omega. The Omega resets the day so that the humans can be defeated, because the mimics know what they're going to do and how they're going to do it, and they destroy them that way. Okay? The movie, what was it called? The Edge of Tomorrow? But their slogan is live, die, repeat, just like a video game. You live, you get killed, you start all over again, and you learn something every time. That's what the movie was based on. Now remember, we've already been told by CERN scientists that they realize that there is a possibility that they may have already warped time in a fraction of a second, but they did it. Are they going to do it again? Daniel chapter 7, verse 25. This Bible's right. God knows everything. He is the Most High. He is higher than everybody. He can see everything. Daniel 7:25 is about this man of sin, the son of perdition, the beast that is not yet is. The beast who is a white black person, who is a male female, androgynous. He is a creator and destroyer. That's who it's talking about. Daniel 7:25 says, and he shall speak great words against the Most High and shall wear out the saints of the Most High. Revelation chapter 13 says, the beast makes war with the saints and prevails against them. I remember reading that and I went, oh, wow. The beast will think to change times and laws. And they shall be given into his hand until a time and times and the dividing of time. Now, some say, now that's 3.5 years. You know, time is a year. Time is 3 years. And then a dividing of time is a half a year. Maybe. Maybe. I'm not disagreeing with that. Maybe. But to me, it's interesting that the language here used does not specify years or days or weeks or months. It mentions the word time. And it specifically says that this beast, whose tongue thou shalt not utter, he is a man of fierce countenance, the Bible says. He shall think to change times and laws. And God is going to let him do it. Now, I know I hear the music playing, but I've got to cue that one. Because we've already been told that CERN has already manipulated time. No, they haven't gone back and changed our Bibles. Cut that stuff out. Go watch Mandela Effect Madness. 2-hour Pastor Mike Online. I dealt with this. Nailed it. The Word of God is incorruptible, people. Nobody gets to go back in time and alter your Bible. Because if they did, that would make God a liar. And God's not a man that he should lie. Your Bible's not been changed. Okay? But the beast, somehow, some way, is going to have the ability to manipulate and change time. We'll look at that Thursday. Pure Bible study coming out tomorrow. Watchman broadcast. I'll be recording it tomorrow. You pray for us. We pray for you. You're the reason why we do what we do. Always remember, help us out. Pray for us. Share the videos with people. Call us, write us if you want copies of the DVDs, Elements of Wrath and the audio that goes with it, the CDs. We'll see you later. God bless you. Tomorrow night's church night, 7 o'clock. Be there. Bye.